Welcome to the show. I'm Ryan McNeese, and as Tom introduced at the beginning, I have a law office here in Spokane, McNeese Wheeler. I'm also a part of a media company, SpokaneTalksOnline.com. I host a weekly show, Business Talks and Let's Talk Spokane. And I'm honored to be here today. This is a topic that is revolutionary and just as interesting to me in the legal field as you and the diverse fields that you're here at the conference to investigate. We have a great panel of folks today. I'd like to introduce them and have each of them are going to get an opportunity to tell us a little about themselves and dive into some real interesting aspects of this revolutionary field. We have with us today J.D. Claridge, CEO and co-founder of XCraft. Thank you. We have Michael Dement Myers, aviation safety inspector, FAA. Joseph Williams, Washington Governor Jay Inlings, ICT industry sector lead and state of Washington economic development director. And we also have Kara Rowe, visual storyteller at North by Northwest Productions. Thank you guys all for being here. We need some mics, I believe. We have one right here, and we'll start by passing around, but I believe we have a couple extras that we can use as well. Well, because we're starting with one microphone, let's start with Joseph. Joseph, tell us a little bit about your expertise in this field.
All right. So I'm the co-chair of the Unmanned Systems Industry Council. So if you think about unmanned systems, there is the vehicle component, which the aerospace sector lead, John Thornquist, is involved with. And then there's what happens after the vehicle is passed. So if there's data gathered, or if you think about a drone as an Internet of Things endpoint, the data is going to be processed in some fashion. That's the piece I deal with. And so quite a few companies in Seattle who are looking at what you would call drones, saying it's going to produce a lot of data. What do we do with it? I'm responsible for seeing that sector of the economy grow. And so I spend a lot of time on that. So John does the vehicle side, I do the data side.
Thank you, Joseph. Go ahead, JD.
Sure. I'm JD Claridge, CEO and co-founder of XCraft. XCraft is a company that develops drones, or UAVs, and we're based in Coeur d'Alene. I spoke this morning, if you caught that talk, and excited to be here and give the perspective of the technology and where we're headed into the future.
Thank you, Kara.
And I'm Kara, and I kind of have an interesting perspective. Yes, I am a storyteller, AKA producer, or predator, producer, editor over at North by Northwest. But also, I am the proud wife of a UAV pilot. Are there any other wives here today? There's a reason for that, guys. It's kind of a special, place for those of us who are kind of outside the box from all of you. I've been with my husband through this whole process. We bought our first drone about 5 years ago. And so we lived through the gray area. Who else has lived through the gray area? Okay. We struggled through that a little bit with the FAA. No offense, Mike. But and then just recently through the Section 333, and now 6 months ago, the Part 107. For that, you know, I guess what I bring to this discussion is a little bit of both perspectives, one from a storyteller perspective, but then also one who has been with my husband through this process, been his business partner, been his left-sided mind through some of this, and I'm here to kind of share some of those stories and perspectives on all of it.
Thank you, Kara.
Good day, Mike Dement Myers. My background is United States Air Force, flew 7 years active duty there. Then I flew with, at the time, in situ, now they're kind of Boeing in situ, flying scan Eagles off of Navy ships for 3 years. And then I went down to Edwards Air Force Base with Northrop Grumman, doing a flight test on the Global Hawk. So kind of an operator experience, and now I'm with the FAA, more of a regulator.
Thank each of you for the background. And I think one point that came to mind right off the bat, Kara, you mentioned that this is an industry that's had significant gray area, mainly, like most industries that are new. The laws haven't necessarily caught up with the use. Excuse me. And what we have here, we're fortunate to have each individual on the panel that really represents a different critical area of this industry. With the FAA, obviously, you have regulation, important regulation, and has had to have the opportunity to catch up with the uses out there that at sometimes folks can't necessarily predict what type of uses will be there. The creative side, Kara, in your category, JD, I think you're obviously in the consumer use. How can these be used? How can we creatively use these both residentially and commercially? And Joseph, also legislatively. So with this panel, we really do have the critical aspects of an industry that's been transitioning. If we maybe could come back to the beginning with Joseph and talk about legislatively, where have we been, where are we, and where do you think we're going with this ever-changing industry?
So this has been an interesting year. We had three bills introduced into the Washington legislature this year. One specifically addressed drones in the proximity of orca pods. One specifically addressed private property rights related to drone overflight, and one addressed the state's use of drones for its own agency purposes. All three bills are likely not to pass or hit the governor's desk, but they each were reacting to different concerns. So there is a concern about drones and its impact on wildlife and wilderness areas and things like that. And so there is a constituency that's looking at that. Nobody really wants to fly a drone into a bunch of orcas. That's not the problem they were trying to solve. They were trying to solve a tourism nuisance problem. Private property, though, is a big issue. There is a private property interest in being able to protect the airspace over your house or your ranch. That conflicts with the property rights interests of delivery folks and surveying folks and things like that. I've seen some beautiful photography since I've been here. If the bill, privacy bill had passed, none of that photography would have been possible. That would have been prohibited under that legislation without express written consent of the property owner. You can imagine how complex that would be for an Amazon or a commercial photographer. The one regulating state agencies is just trying to deal with, well, what do these things mean to us as a state and our citizenry, and how do we protect their rights? And so I think what you're going to see in the next couple of sessions is more concern about, we want to encourage economic development. It's very important. That's what I do. But we also want to protect the interests of citizens. We just don't know what those are. So there will be a statewide, this is not a Republican-Democrat issue. Mm-hmm. This is not an urban-rural issue. This is really, what do you think about private property rights? What do you think about economic velocity and those kinds of things? And very complicated times. And so I'm sure, JD, you probably see a lot of this in how you sell your product, right?
Yes, definitely. I think it's an interesting perspective. I mean, we're out there kind of pushing the technology, but we know that there is a lot going on in everybody keeping up. I mean, with the FAA, I think you got to hand it to the FAA with how fast they came out with Part 107, honestly, to allow commercial operation. The FAA doesn't normally move that fast, and they did. I've been involved with them for quite some time, so that's really encouraging to see that even though the technology is moving fast, it seems like regulations are starting to move faster, which is what we need, and that allows us to be able to do our job and to really push the envelope for technology's sake and also, you know, benefiting mankind. So, but there's a lot of important legislative issues to wrestle with, and I'm glad that they're happening.
JD, would you say that the regulations, whether it be the FAA or state legislation, does it allow you to identify, maybe ascertain what your market either currently is or what it's going to be? Maybe you can speak a little bit to that in terms of, as proposed legislation comes about, how it allows you to potentially shift your business interests.
Sure. So
we definitely have seen the concern, I would say the privacy concerns,
sure.
and have heard those. We actually set up a website where you can go and register your own personal airspace. It's called nodronezone.com. you can actually, and not to be confused with the FAA, also has, I think, nodronezone.org or .gov, one of those. Anyway, so you can go and register, and just basically our drones would stay out, as long as you can prove that that's your property, our drones would stay out of that airspace. And that's something that, you know, we're looking to that too. Obviously, we want to bring the right product to our customer. Mm-hmm. And if our customer, you know, is concerned about privacy, as I think a lot of us are, we want to be able to address that. So that's one example of how mm-hmm. we've responded to that. And as we've seen a lot of the other bills come through, and many of them haven't gone through to the governor, as Joseph said, but it's interesting to see how kind of the society in general is reacting to drones. We're in such an infancy of this mm-hmm. whole industry, and technology is moving very fast, and so it's not all going to be smooth. And so, but it's exciting to be on the technology side of it.
I think that's a good point, JD. And as we spoke actually a little bit before the show, there are often times with ever-changing industries, as the laws attempt to catch up, there's also some balance or perspective there that if you really look closely, there's actually laws in place for previous technologies that really probably accommodate some of the anxieties of the public. One we spoke of was privacy. Cameras, telephoto lenses, et cetera, and potentially invading folks' privacy from a distance has been a concern for many, many, many years. Obviously, that is a current concern of potentially having a drone hovering over your backyard or search and seizures, illegal search and seizures. But there are criminal laws in place already for some of those breaches as well as privacy. So it's going to be an interesting balance to see. And Kara, I find what's interesting about the human nature of this issue is the stories that potentially couldn't have been told before that can be told in different ways now. Tell us a little bit about that.
You bet. Ryan, hey, could you play the very first video that I have there? And this will give us a little bit of perspective. You know, from the entertainment world, which is the world that I live in, you know, drones are such a fantastic tool. Mm-hmm. You know, before we had drones, we had to use either helicopters or planes. And let me tell you, if you guys have ever tried to take photos outside of a plane, well, you do. If you fly, it's hard, isn't it? And you never get the shot that you want. Helicopters are a little bit easier, but to use a drone and to be able to do it cheaper, more efficiently, faster, and then also to be able to get into nooks and crannies that you otherwise wouldn't be able to get into, from an entertainment perspective, that has just opened up the box exponentially for us. I chatted with Rich Cowan yesterday about this. He just came back from a movie set down in Atlanta, and you know, just the ability to be able to now capture things in a safer way than we were before. I know that's shocking to say, but also in a way that just uses the resources correctly. You know, there's still always going to be a need for cranes. Our great friend Greg Ritchie has cranes because actors don't necessarily want a drone right here as they're laying out their scenes, right? Mm-hmm. So there's always going to be a need for other types of technology. But as I was talking with a gentleman right before this panel, you know, the future of this industry, you know, we always say, JD, you know, how much further can the technology go? But it's just like these things. I mean, I grew up in the age when cameras were 30 pounds and we had to pack them on our back. And now I can get better quality video out of this silly little thing than I can with the, you know, some of the larger cameras that we had just 5 years ago. So from an entertainment perspective, from a storytelling perspective, yes, there are amazing scenes that we can get now that we couldn't have gotten even 3 years ago. Ryan, if you want to play that, I'm showing you a video real quick here. This is actually an Oscar-winning piece. No, we did not shoot it, so we can't take credit for it. But this is Skyfall, if we have any James Bond fans in the house.
Where are they now?
They appear to be on the rooftops of the Grand Bazaar.
Wow, how many aerial photos do you see in that shot, in that scene? This won the Oscar for aerial videography in 2012, I believe it was. But it shows you what we can do now. And just to think about the technical aspect of that, when those motorcycles were coming down that roof line mm-hmm. and the drone came up at just the right time, to catch them at the right point in the camera screen. You know, you think about all those technical aspects and how many times did they shoot that? I'm guessing only a couple because there's so much pressure. Wouldn't you agree, Greg? There's a lot of pressure on a movie set. You've only got a, yes, you've only got a short period of time, even though it's a movie set, you have to get it right the first or second time. So again, yes, drones have this great capacity to give us even more amazing footage, both for our world, but for your world as realtors, as inspectors. It's just a neat, neat tool.
Yeah, and I think you're making a really good point that not only from a safety standpoint in terms of the movie sets or the creative industries, but also from a cost-effective standpoint, the sets and or the mechanisms that would have to be put together to capture the shots that they just showed versus using these devices. So there's a cost effective, safety, and creatively, it looks pretty cool too. So, and JD, is that something, do you see in this area that your involvement in the industry, that the entertainment industry might play a part in that as well in terms of the market?
I think there's a really big market potential. I mean, I think as a whole, the movie industry was one of the first to really start using UAVs and drones in actual and under the original 333 exemption process. And I see, I'll give another plug for X-Craft here if you don't mind, but
no,
we are heading in that direction where with our vertical takeoff and landing and high speed drone that we have, there's a need for shooting sometimes fast-moving subjects or cars, and so we see a definite need for something that can carry a decent camera for cinematography work, but also travel fast and potentially fly for a long period of time because you need time to set up the shot and get it right. So that's something we're working on.
Well, as we said at the outset of this particular segment, all of your respective industries play such a critical role in bringing this industry forward for the folks that are out here as well and your specialized interests. I think we'll probably move to the segment, if we can, of some Q&A and see if folks in the crowd have some questions for our panelists. Go ahead, Joseph.
One thing I want to point out, I'm a drone operator in Seattle. If you haven't seen it, City of Seattle has sent its first drone operator to jail. Drone operator inadvertently smacked his drone into the head of a woman in a protest movement, and he was sentenced to 30 days. Has that had a chilling effect on my drone operation? It actually has. I live downtown, and so I think about what I'm doing. I'm also concerned as an economic development guy about what that means for y'all, because many of you are drone operators, and if there are criminal penalties as opposed to just tort liability, that could be bad. So we're actually trying to work with the cities, and you should think about this with your local folks, about what does it mean if you're a drone operator and certain scenarios play out? Because you don't really want to go to jail for inadvertently hitting somebody with your drone. I get it that it's reckless endangerment, maybe, which is the statute under which that poor guy was sentenced, but it has a chilling effect on what people are doing with drones in the city of Seattle, and that could happen here in Spokane as well. So you need to pay attention to that. And I was kind of curious if the FAA is thinking about any kind of criminal penalties that accrue to what they're doing on the drone side.
Do you have any comments on that, Michael?
Yeah, in general, yeah.
Oh, yeah, there's penalties out there. This particular individual at the time basically got an education letter. And that's part of our compliance enforcement philosophy, is to first educate if it's not an egregious or act or on purpose or you're belligerent and resist any kind of counseling or training. So that's what happened to this individual.
So knowing the parameters in which you're utilizing these devices is the clear advice there, I think, Joseph, right?
Exactly, yeah.
Are there questions from the crowd? Are there some other questions out there? I have a question. Go ahead.
First of all, thank you all for being here. Awesome. We're enjoying all the education that you guys are offering. One of the things that I would like to know is in the realm of personal privacy, when we notify neighbors that we're filming a property in a densely occupied area, we've been trying to go next door, knock on doors, let them know so that it's not a shock when they see the drone. Talk to us a little bit about that and who should be doing that. Should it be the agent? Should it be the drone operator? What method should we be using to effectively let neighbors to the side and to the back of the property know that there's going to be a drone in the air?
So Kara mentioned this earlier, I think that was you, that right now there's a bunch of current rules that apply. There's no specific statewide legislation at the moment because none of that passed. So what you're talking about is you can't stalk someone with your drone because that's illegal, right? Stalking is illegal. You can't spy on people in a harassing manner because that's functionally illegal. So what you have to do is think about, I would say, good neighbor policy. It's if you're going to film and if you have the ability to give prior notice, you should give prior notice. That said, I run my drone up and down the Ship Canal in Seattle all the time. That's my favorite filming site. I don't want to tell each one of the sailboat operators, you know, and go get prior permission for that. So you're treading a fine line on that one. But by and large, I figure if they're in public view, they don't mind too bad if I film them. But that's common usage, right? You get to a point where you can't go film the Seahawks from a drone. That's been explicitly prohibited. You can't go into controlled airspace. That's really bad. There are things which you have to pay attention to. That said, I believe in the next 2 to 4 years, we'll see some legislation that tries to lock in privacy rights. And I think we'll see some legislation that tries to lock in delivery rights. And so these things will be in contention. But I think prior notice, it's just the neighborly thing to do.
That's a good question. Go ahead in the far back there.
The commercial air, they were sued by that person, so it didn't affect the FAA, but it was tens of thousands of dollars that the company ended up paying to that individual that walked out on their deck. So just a heads up on the more you kind of get in those circles of who's actually, it doesn't always
That's a good point, though. Well worth potentially doing your due diligence, spending that extra 5 minutes. That's a good point. Mr. Lalonde here.
Yeah, I read in the paper where Amazon is going to be delivering by drones. And so have they been, is this actually happening? Have they been given permission and the license to do that?
Or is the question?
To paraphrase the question, Mr. Lalonde was asking, has Amazon got actual clearance, licensing, permitting, et cetera, to deliver packaging here in the communities?
I'll answer, I guess. So no, not currently in the U.S. They are operating on a very limited basis, I believe, in the U.K. They've only done one or two deliveries, basically just to prove the concept. But no, if you really look at it, the challenges associated with delivery drones are huge, not just privacy issues, but also sense and avoid of other aircraft and all the other challenges that go along with that, and trees and everything else. So I think that's going to be many years down the road, likely, before we see actual packages being delivered by Amazon. But it is obviously something they're working on, so likely will happen.
Thank you.
It's a weird thing to think about, but the Uniform Commercial Code doesn't address what happens when you deliver via drone.
That's a good
and
point.
So we got to have some of the law catch up with that. At least that's my understanding. Not an attorney, but that's what I've been told.
Nope, I think you're right. Go ahead.
Twice.
And was recovered with the registration. I never did hear what happened to that drone operator for flying his drone into a landmark.
Yeah, so he lawyered up fairly quickly, and the communication just kind of died. However, the investigation is almost complete on him. They know where he lives, and they know who he is. So stand by on that.
To be continued. Go ahead in the back left there.
From a standpoint of real estate, we can go to Google Maps, we can go to Google Earth, we can go to Spokane, our municipality website, pull up maps and aerial photographs of anything. So what's going to differentiate between the current to the moment flying with aerial photographs and this blanket image?
So there is an emerging view around Google Street Maps and Google Earth that you have a right to be forgotten or removed. So there are some countries which have already legislated that there has to be some process for removal if you request it and you meet certain kinds of criteria. I don't see us moving in that direction, but I have heard that Google has removed some sites in the U.S. Yes, you have a point on that one? Because I don't know.
I have a neighbor that when Google came by and took the photos, his family was in the garage, and he called them. And now if you look at his house on Google Earth, his house is grayed out. You can't see anything.
Yeah, that's what I understand. So
within hours of him calling them.
But I think exactly to your point, we don't know. And this is all developing. So this comes back to what is our right to privacy? What is our right to be forgotten? How does that operate? What does that look like? And we're not very far away from SpaceX putting low orbital satellites everywhere. They'll be able to snap everything. And we don't have any law that covers any of that right now. So think of them as high altitude drones that stay up for a long time.
Kara, do you have a?
You know, I would just add from he talked about the rules. And I would say from a marketing perspective, how many realtors do we have here? I'm going to guess the majority. Okay. Do we have any public servants? One, two, okay. Three. You don't count.
No. I'm just kidding. And then how many photographers do we have? Huh? Very good, quite a few. So I guess one other side to think about that, yes, you can show your client, you can show properties via the satellite photos, but you compare those with some of the images that we saw prior to this panel, and it's just not the same, is it? It's just not the same. So from a marketing perspective, I would say Google, at least now, what we know now, not knowing what future technology is going to be, you are still going to get a more personal touch by using aerial images rather than a Google Maps images. In fact, guys, the same thing is happening in agriculture. That's another outside-the-box industry that drones are being used in. For mapping, for other things, but it's just not the same detail as you get if you fly the crop season by season, month by month. So those kind of little intricacies, I would say just from a marketing perspective, you know, you're going to get emotion from something like what we just saw, whereas a Google Map, you're not going to get that same kind of emotion.
Thank you.
And I'll add to that a little bit, too. I mean, not only that, but there's also times where you want to shoot at a specific time, right? And the satellite goes over who knows when, and so that image could be delayed potentially quite a bit. So there are times also where you'd need a drone or some other aircraft to get that shot.
Thank you. Unfortunately, we're out of time, but that's then, now, and next for drones. And our thank you to our panelists. And I think there's going to be some time afterward where the panelists will take some further questions in the back. And thank you very much. Appreciate it.
Thank you.
All right.
If I could have Joseph stay for just a little bit, he did bring a couple of slides, and I wanted to be sure we included them while he's here. And so in the next couple of minutes, let's go through those slides. Joseph, do you have some narration you can offer about the slides that you brought
sure.
with you?
Who's going to advance, or do I do that?
You have the power.
Here, right this way. Do you want to sit here?
All right, in the state of Washington, we actually are aggressively competing with Oregon, North Dakota, and Colorado. Hate those guys. North Dakota and Oregon were early participants in the FAA's Pathfinder program, and so they've got some early R&D. We're playing a little bit of catch-up. But what we're seeing is, of course, with Amazon, we've got a thought leader. Amazon's drone team is quite large. We got the ag drone angle that Kara mentioned, and we've also we've got some teams doing search and rescue. Interesting things on that front. I'll just go to the next one. So what are we focused on? We're focused on research and development. University of Washington and Washington State both have drone programs. So if you want to be a young scholar, you're really interested in this, you've gotten involved in racing and you want to go to the university, you've got two good universities in place, plus a hand just went up. Well, I'll talk about Big Ben in a second. And then we've got Big Ben with the pilot. They teach drone pilots, certified drone pilots. I hear Central's thinking of doing something similar, so you guys want to keep your lead going. We focus a lot on vehicle design, manufacture, and service. So you probably heard about In Situ down in Klickitat County. They make military drones. You may not know that in Woodinville, we've got Free Fly Systems that employs 55 people. They make drones for movie camera chassis. We're trying to encourage that. We are also, what I do is work on the back end. We have quite a few companies in the state who are doing data analytics, working with infrared and all those, the science side of drones. The state's really interested in increasing the population of commercial drone operators, which is why the state's invested in Big Bend and Ellensburg and some other places to try to get those programs up and running. Recreational drone operation is a huge, huge, huge hot topic because we've got the racing, which we love, but then we've got people who don't like drones flying overhead as they're hiking through the wilderness areas, and so we're still trying to hammer out what's going to happen in terms of policy. on the recreation side, but we think it's very important. And I think personally drone racing is going to take off. It's a low entry fun activity. It's a lot cheaper than trying to learn how to ski and going to Breck every year or Vail or something like that. And then last but not least, we've got a lot of research going on or a lot of work going on in the first responder search and rescue and relief side. We do have, if you're into drones, you should be part of the Unmanned Systems Industry Council. It meets quarterly. It actually lobbies for and against legislation in Olympia. It was founded last year. I'm one of the co-chairs. One of the other big stakeholders in the state is the Department of Transportation. The Department of Transportation is very interested in drones and how they might affect the ways in which roads are used. And then the Washington legislature, as I mentioned earlier, is all over drones. We've got to keep a good eye on those. Those are the three bills I mentioned. This deck is available to anybody, by the way. So if you want to take a look at these, I would encourage you to do so. I don't believe any of them will pass. There is a Federal Drone Advisory Council. Amazon has membership on that, and so they represent us. They report back to us on what's going on. They just had a meeting. They split into subgroups. They're putting a lot of thought into what the drone economy should look like. The next meeting is on May 3rd. I tried to get onto the DAC. It didn't happen, but we got someone from Amazon, and that was good enough. What we have coming up, so the statewide kind of industry group is the AUSVI. They have a meeting, or VSI, sorry. They have a meeting on April 6th at Joint Base Lewis-McChord. Our next USIC meeting is June 13th. It's open to anybody who would like to attend. And then we'll do a fall meeting somewhere in Eastern Washington. For whatever reason, Sunnyside wants the meeting, but we want to do it in Spokane, so we'll see how that actually goes. And so that's my deck. I will tell you, the university work that's going on with drones would just floor you. And then you may not know this, but PNNL is also doing a lot of work with drones. They're trying to figure out how to use drones for infrastructure inspection. So you can imagine with all the infrastructure for power, that needs to be inspected routinely, and PNNL is spending a lot of time and effort doing so. So thank you very much. But you should know, we're very involved in the drone industry. We're here to support you. Thank you.
Another round of applause for our panel members, please. Thank you, one and all. Ron, you may dismiss your crew. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen.
Grab this.
If these two end chairs look really comfortable to your eyes, they will look really comfortable to your backside also. We are offering in a fishbowl over here a drawing. The company Home Staging Works has been super in setting this up for us. They tell us that they don't really need to take these back to the warehouse, and they'd be very happy if one of us wins the drawing to take them home. So you'll want to put your business card in the fishbowl there at the end of the left-hand stage. The sofa apparently does have an afterlife after this conference, but the two end chairs are going to be in the drawing this afternoon. Our thanks to Home Staging Works. Why don't we give them a hand of applause, too, because they made us feel real at home here today. Okay, we have about 8 minutes for a break. Feel free to visit the vendors in the back of the hall. If you'd like to get started with flying your own drone, Drone Flight 101, stay right here in the conference hall. We have a session called Prescription for Success Sustained. We have a doctor, a lawyer, and a drone pilot. The three of them are going to be in the classroom directly across the lobby. Pick the session that appeals to you. That session will conclude at 3 o'clock, and then we'll have another round where you can choose your content. You'll see it on your flight plan. So, Home Drone 17 continues. Pick your session. We'll see you at the top of the hour. Thank you.